Welcome back to my classroom. This is Justin. Today I'm going to discuss the concept of normal curve. Normal curve is the most important concept when I talk to generally deal with the quantitative research method. When I take my classes, every day I used to draw this normal curve on the board. My students used to get irritated when I draw this normal curve. So it's a basic of a quantitative research method. Especially we often use this thing in level of significance or a particular test. Inferential statistics is significant or not significant, like that. So I have my own way to explain this concept of normal curve. So let us consider an example here. Think about a data. This is a data. So I have a student, a set of students, let us say 12 students. One of them got a score of 10, three of them got a score of 20, and five of them got a score of 30, two of them scored a score of 40, and one of them got a score of 50, a usual pattern. So I have 12 students and their marks is given in a frequency distribution pattern. Hope this is a very easy concept. And what if you draw this thing in a graphical format? So I have a graph here, x-axis, y-axis, marks here, and number of people here. And these points are plotted here. What if I connect these lines and make a kind of point, a graph? So I may get a graph, something like this. So this is a usual frequency distribution of this particular data, and let us look into this curve. It looks like a perfect curve for me. The major reason is look at the curve here. This curve is having a kind of pattern where majority of the sample fall in the average range. Or if you look at this data here, majority of them are between 20 and 40. See that? 3, 5, 2, and very few people in the extreme level. So this is a normal curve. Why it is a normal curve? The one easy way to explain this is it represents the usual data. It represents the usual data means if you go to any kind of, if you take any kind of variable, it tend to be follow a pattern like this. That is, majority of them will be in the center level and some people in the extreme level. As we go to the extreme, the number of people reduce. Go to any classroom and see how many of them get average mark. Majority of them get average mark. Some of them fail, some of them get extreme marks. Any characteristics, take any character, it may follow that pattern. So in that context, if you take a sample from a population which follows a normal curve, and what if you get a sample also normal distributed, that it's an indication of considering that my sample may be representing the population. It is not necessary always, because what if you have a population which is not normally distributed, a variable which is not normally distributed. From that, if you take a number of sample and you take average of the data, and if you plot like this, you again may get a random a normal curve. It is possible. That means your population is not necessarily normally distributed to get a sample which is normally distributed. This is one of the assumption of central limit theorem. So so we have a distribution like this. This can be considered as a normal distribution, and the term normal distribution was proposed by two people. One is Gauss and Laplace. So that's why this curve also called as a Gaussian curve, to represent, to honor his works. And this is also called as normal error curve. The reason was when these people, Laplace and Gauss, they were working with astronomy and physics. So they were doing some kind of assessment. During that process, they found out that there are some errors happening in the assessment. And the errors means from the true score, how much data is deviating. This error scores tend to be normally distributed like this. So they also call this as a normal error curve or error curve like that. So these are different terms used for this particular curve. So this is not really a normal curve. This is a frequency distribution representation, a graphical representation of a frequency distribution. What if you have a different set of data, or what if you need to represent any data that you get in this pattern? or a curve which can accommodate any kind of data, then two things are difficult for you. One is the xy axis, the number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. In this particular graph, the number from 1 to 6 can be accommodated, or that is different for different kind of data. And in this particular data, the marks are ranging from 0 to 60. Not necessarily, if you take different variable, the scores may change from different pattern. So what if you need to convert draw a graph or a curve which can accommodate any kind of data? Now it is a real data. What if a real curve? What if you need to get a curve which can accommodate in any kind of distribution or any kind of scores? So for that, what if imagine that, let us say 100 students, and you can accommodate them in this number itself, a particular range itself. Or what if you create an equation so that this curve peakness would be always the same? That the curve peakness would be always the same, based on the number we take the proportion of the data and convert in that way. It is possible, right? So these people, those who worked with this Gaussian curve and normal curve, they developed an equation to find out, to decide what should be the peakness of each these points based on this particular values. So whatever may be the values we get, let us say we have a set of scores here, x-axis marks or extroversion or happiness, whatever may be the scores here, and you will have a frequency scores here, right? So whatever may be the frequency score, that can be converted to a pattern which look the same all for all kind of data, so that the curve parameters will be same. So they have an equation for that. We generally consider this as an equation of a normal curve itself. It is a probability density function. So that means it's a P, that's probability density function of X, a value X. That means, let us say a value X. And what should be the height of the curve if the value is 20? That means this X will be 20 then. Okay, and it is equal to, it's a complicated equation. You don't need to really learn this. I'm just saying that how this can be change to a pattern where any kind of data can be accommodated. So you have 1 divided by 2 pi into standard deviation and exponential score of minus x minus mean mu score square of it divided by 2 standard deviation square. So this is the value. Okay, so look at the score here. So this is the equation of normal curve. So equation of normal curve means what should be the height of each point. See that? So you can ignore this particular axis because this would be the remain same, this range would remain the same, because whatever value you get here, the score will be converted to a different score based on this particular equation. So even if you do not have this particular axis, it's fine because the unit tend to be the same itself. So how do we rework on this? So any value on the x-axis, so you have a frequency data ranging from 200 to 800, it can be accommodated in this section. Fine, using this equation, you can just convert it. And what if, that means you can ignore this particular axis itself. I'm just going to remove this, erase this from the graph itself. So here we go. I have removed the y-axis. So even if you remove the y-axis, not a problem, because tend to be same for any kind of data. Based on the number of the frequency, the scores will be changed. Now, what about this particular thing? So some data may be ranging from 200 to 300 or 0 to 10, like that, anything can happen. What if you can convert this entire data to another format? For example, what if the center point here, the center point here is 0, okay, and each values are basic units are a standard deviation. That means there's an equation generally called as z value, z value. This is called a standard score. That means any particular point can be converted to the standard score based on equation like the value minus mean, I'm using a mu value, mean divided by standard error. So assume that this particular data has a mean of 30 and standard deviation of 10, deviation from the center, basic unit of 10. And if this is a condition, how do you convert each value? So here this particular point, the mean value, center point here is 30 minus 30 divided by 10. it's basically zero. Same way, what if you take this point, 20 minus 30 divided by 10, you'll get minus 1. You get here minus 2. And if you have another point here, it will be minus 3. Same way, you have plus 1, plus 2, and plus 3, like that. See that? So I have another point and a pattern here. Instead of a raw score here, or usual raw score, what was the raw score original value? 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60. I have another value which is 0, plus 1, 2, 3. It's actually plus 1 standard deviation, plus 2 standard deviation, and plus 3 standard deviation. Here is minus 1 standard deviation, minus 2 standard deviation, and minus 3 standard deviation. So I have another pattern of data here. Instead of raw data, I have Z score here. So what's the benefit of the Z score? Like the height, the score is standard for any kind of data. I can accommodate any kind of data in this range. Let it be ranging from 0 to 200, it can be accommodated here. So now you don't need to really worry about this particular values here. Now this is called as a condition where x-axis and y-axis can accommodate any kind of values. Now this is a theoretical curve. If you don't consider this raw data, you have a curve here which is a theoretical curve. Theoretical curve means it can accommodate any kind of data. It is not a practical real representation of this particular data. It can accommodate any kind of score. Now this is called as a normal curve. That's such a simple concept. It's a theoretical curve, basically a theoretical curve. So what are the characteristics of a normal curve? If you take the highest peak point of it, this is the peak point of it, and if you try to see what is the point related to the x-axis here, now this will be the mean of the distribution. See that? And this mean will be equal to median, and that will be equal to mode. This is a condition of a very interesting characteristics of a normally distributed data, a normal curve, mean equal to median equal to mode. And another characteristics of a normal distribution is its symmetrical nature. Symmetric means it divides the center line, this divides the entire distribution to two, and equal to, it's same, equal to in terms of the number of people here and number of people here would be same. That's why they said it's symmetrical. Same means almost same, like that. Okay, that's second property. Another property is the asymptotic property. Asymptotic property means this line will never touch the x-axis. For example, let us look, consider this graph is a representation of this data. You don't have a zero score here. Nobody with zero. So if you want to, you know, if you want to really draw this graph for this particular data, you will have a zero score and number of people will be zero. So this has to touch here, x-axis. It has to touch the x-axis. And here, number of people who got a score of 60. So that here, it will be zero. So that has to touch there. A real curve will touch the x-axis, but a theoretical curve, what if somebody else consider take a data where few people get zero score, few people get a score of 60, so this cannot touch anywhere. So generally in a normal curve, it extend like this, it extend like this, it will never touch the x-axis. So if it never touch the x-axis, how do we start counting then? So generally in a normal curve, we start counting from here. I mean 0, 1, minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, like that. 0, 1, 2, 3, like that. So it start from a normal curve, start from the mean value toward this side and towards that side. Okay, very interesting property of a normally distributed data. And what is the peak point of this particular data? So it can be any kind of unit, let us say a basic unit, this score, the height of the maximum peakness of the score, the curve tend to be 0.39 maximum. Okay, the maximum line. So it can be any unit, okay, it can be centimeter, it can be meter, or whatever may be the unit. In that unit, if you take one particular unit, in that 0.39 would be the peakness of the curve. Okay, that tend to be the peakness of the curve. So this is another characteristics of a normally distributed data. And now the most important characteristics of a normal distributed data, or I will say that what is the application of normal distributed? It is basically the concept of the area under normal curve. The area. So what is the area under normal curve? Look at the entire graph here. and try to connect with the data that we have. We have 12 students here, and all 12 students are presented there. So let us say 10, 1%. This is a person here, 1%. 23 people, 35 people, and 42 people, and 51 of them. It's basically people. So if you take the entire data from this point till this point, you get 100% of the people. See that? And what if you take this half of it? It has to be 50% and this has to be 50%. See that? So the area under normal curve means this is, so if you take half out of 12, this much area should be 6, that means 50% of 12, and this much area should be another 6 people, that's 50% of the 12, like that. So this is an area under normal curve. So this looks very simple, but how it is complicated, or what's the real application of this? At any area, at any point, let us say I say an area like this, a point here, if the data is normally distributed, I can find out how many people are from this point towards this end, or to above that or below that, like this. So that means I need to find out how many people have a score more than 15. So I can really calculate the area under normal curve from this point to this entire area here, and I can calculate how many people would be there. This particular property is the most important application of area under normal curve. So that is why in general people always try to see whether data is normally distributed or not. I'm sorry, the reason for actually calculating whether data is normally distributed or not, for the property of this mean, arithmetic mean, or any kind of mean. Because if data are not normally distributed, if it is skewed, we'll discuss that concept later, what is the concept of skewness. If the data is skewed, I cannot really trust the mean value. That's a very serious problem. Or if the data has peakedness, then I cannot really work on the data because I cannot it's not a real representation of the population. So generally people check whether data is normally distributed or not to identify proper statistics. It's parametric or non-parametric, like that. If you are familiar with this concept, you must be definitely heard about the parametric and non-parametric analysis, which is a kind of decision that we generally make based on whether data is normally distributed or not. Not always, not all analysis, some of the analysis, normal distribution is very important. For example, t-test is very important. But for the regression analysis, normality of the data is not assumption. Residuals has to be normally distributed. For some kind of application of normality always. So now, going back to the concept of area under normal curve. So if you take this particular point, minus one standard deviation, that means 0, 1. This particular point, if I draw a line here, so this area from this point, that is 0, this point minus 1, here it is 30 and 20, if you take this particular application. Otherwise, in general, 0 to minus 1, this area tend to be 34.13% of the people tend to fall between 20 marks and 30 marks. Same way, 30 and 40, the same 34.13. Generally, we take 34 itself. So how many people are fall between 20 to 40? That means minus one standard deviation to plus one standard deviation, or minus one to plus one. This tend to be 34 plus 34. It is 68% of the people fall between these two points. So it's a clear average. And what about the people who fall between minus one standard deviation to minus two standard deviation? That is this area, this particular area. These score tend to be 13.59, generally consider 14. Okay, this area is 13.59, yeah, percentage of the total population. So this is the extent part of it. The remaining is this side. If you want much more detail, minus 2, 1, 2, minus 3 standard deviation, this area tend to be 2.14%, and here it is 2.14%. Okay, so what's the remaining place here? I think it's 0.13%, and here you get my 0.13%. Yeah. So this is the concept of area under normal curve. So this is a place, we use this concept to explain many things. Usually in net exam, this property are generally used. You get some maybe so total sample size you may be knowing, and for example 30 is the average of the data, and one of your sample got a score of 20, and what's his percentile position, something like that. So based on that you can understand what's the percentile position of the person based on this particular characteristics. I may be discussing about this when I explain norms in the scale construction area, but basically this is the concept of area under normal curve. So every curve would be like this, or would be normally distributed, not necessarily. Many character variables, if you have done a research, you may be knowing this. Many variables during the data collection procedure, you will understand that they won't be normally distributed. So they will be deviating from the pattern, okay, from the theoretical curve like this. So how do they deviate? There are two common deviations that we generally discuss. One is skewness, other one is kurtosis. So let us see what is skewness and kurtosis. Before that, I need to clean this. So I'll take a moment. So what is skewness? Skewness is whether the data is symmetrical or non-symmetrical. So what if you have a usual curve like this, and this is a perfect normal curve. If you take the center point, half here, 50% here, 50% here, it's a symmetrical curve. What if your data is something like this? You have a left side here, minus here, plus side, and most of the data are fall in the positive side. Now this is called a negatively skewed data. Skewness. Okay, now this is a negatively skewed data, and what if you have a curve like this, where if you take minus and you have plus and majority are here and the curve is going like this. Now this is a positive skewed data. Now this is called a skewness. So what's the problem with having a data like this? It's a very serious problem in terms of research, because take this data, what does it tell us? Majority of the sample falls in this end of the curve. If this is center point, that means somewhere here is a center point, majority of the data is this side, very few people are in this side. Or here, which says that majority of the data in the lower end of the data than the higher end of the data. For example, I need to compare two classes, let us say class A and class B. If this is a condition, or I'll start with the center point, usually good zero skewness curve, a symmetrical curve. If this is a condition, the data giving me a kind of sample where majority are the average, few are low and few are high, a good representation. What if you take this if your sample pattern is this like level, this tells me my sample majority are having very high marks and very few are having the other average or below average marks. That means this class is represented by the people, those who are really academically good in the class. And what if you compare this particular class with another class? It's not a very good comparison. What about this one? This tells me I'm selecting sample from this class who are academically poor in nature, and majority of them fall in that level, very few people from the average and very few people from the people who are exceptionally good. So what happened, this data, they are overrepresented. The people, those who are not academically good, they are overrepresented. Other group is underrepresented. The same condition here, people, those who are studying very well, are overrepresented in the situation. So a condition like this may not be good for a sample, because the sample is really biased data. Another problem with this score is, if you remember when I was discussing at a real normal curve, one of the property that I was discussing was the mean of a normal curve would be same as median and same as mode. Okay, so mean, median, mode would be same, but a curve like this, mean, median, mode won't be same. What if you take a negatively skewed data? The lowest point will be mean, the first value will be mean, because this negative value, the extreme value, will pull that mean value towards the extreme value. So first smallest value will be the mean, and this will be the next value will be the median, and the next value will be the mode like this. See that? So which will be the highest value? This is the highest value here. This will be the pattern of mean, median and mode. Median will be always the center point. So what about this condition? This side would be the mean and center you will get median and thus you will get mode. So which is the smallest value here? Mode is the smallest value here. And highest, the next highest value is median, then you have mean. So the properties are changing. If it is a normally distributed curve, mean, median, mode would be same. Mean, median, mode would be almost same. Now this is a problem with this concept of skewness. It's not a good representation of the sample population, and the especially the value mean, and which cannot be calculated properly because always arithmetic mean is influenced by extreme scores like this. So you cannot trust the arithmetic mean. So if you cannot trust the arithmetic mean, that's it. You cannot do any of the generally any of the parametric test, because let us take any kind of parametric test like a t-test and over and all. It's all basically a combination of arithmetic mean and the standard deviation, or if it is ANOVA, the standard deviation square variance. So if you cannot trust mean, you cannot really work with the arithmetic, the variance or ANOVA t-test like that. So skewness is a very, very important characteristics of it. So how do you calculate skewness? There's a specific equation for skewness, SK skewness. I'm just using a symbol here. SK equal to 3 into mean minus mode, median divided by standard deviation. So this is the equation of one equation of skewness. Otherwise, you can work with another equation where percentile value of 90 plus percentile value of 10 divide by 2. This also is an indicator of skewness. If the skewness score is nearby 0, that indicate data is symmetrical. That means this, it could be a kind of indication of a normal curve. So that's a skewness parameters. So I'll be using this particular concept of normal distribution whenever possible, whenever I have to explain different concepts like inferential statistics, level of significance and other related concepts. So this is it. Normal curve. If you have any doubts, let me know. Okay, that's it. So see you in the next class. Bye.